No tenderness, like grief falls in your fingertips. You're trying hard not to show it. But baby, everyone, this is Gold, aka JR10, or vice versa, however you want to go with it. Got a quick video I want to put together. I hope it's quick. Hold on, I'll be right with you here. Alright, let's see what I got. I'm just setting up the press, trying to answer, still answer, I guess, questions about crimping on straight wall cases. And the only reason I'm addressing this is because I've had a recent flurry of PMs asking more questions. And I hate to keep beating a dead horse, but if this wasn't such a important step in a reloading process, I probably wouldn't get that worked up about it, but it is important. It is potentially dangerous if ignored. So that being said, I'll give you just a quick synopsis of what brought this about. I had a gentleman, send me some questions regarding he was having troubles with failures to feed on 45 ACPs that he was reloading, and that caught my attention because 45 ACPs are where I usually have all new reloaders get their feet wet. It's a very forgiving round for most purposes, if you follow the basics. As I said, it's a good first step in the learning curve of getting into reloading. So let me finish setting up this die and I'll be right back with you here. So I'm back. Like I said, I'm hoping to keep this short, but it is important for those that really want to get into reloading. So I will preface this as my normal. It could be a lengthy video. Slow speech might be evident. My tremors are a little more active today because just got done watching my alma mater, the University of Arizona Wildcats, beating the UCLA Bruins, the number 3 team in the nation, on their home court. Gotta love the Cats. Anyway, back to the story. Anyway, the viewer posed this query about what I might think was going on. Again, he had a 45 ACP, and he was reloading, from what I recall, 230 grain lead cast bullets. And what was happening is when the rounds would feed from the mag into the chamber, they would get caught somewhere on the feed ramp, he indicated. He was wondering if the overall length or maybe the crimp was not right, or maybe it wasn't crimped enough. So I told him that I didn't think it was overall length, excuse me, because it's a pretty standard situation for the 230 grain. I mean, it's a max of 1.275. He did indicate, he was wondering if what the trim, the max, you know, the maximum you could trim the case with. And for all practical purposes, case trimming a 45 or any smooth wall round isn't as, how shall I say, important. It is important if it's necessary, but the forces that are exerted on a smooth wall case aren't exerted in a lengthwise or linear or vertical, I should say. The case, when it's fired, expands mostly around the web area, again also along the length of the case, but it doesn't stretch the case that much. That in comparison to a neck cartridge, this is the arena that case trimming is a lot more important and necessary, because obviously the forces on, or the explosive forces hitting the narrowed end, which is why the pressures are so much more dramatic in rifle rounds, expand the length of the case as well as bulging it. An example, these are fired rounds. This is a 45 ACP. You can see, I hope that it's a fired round. In fact, it still has the used primer in it. And the again, you'll have to excuse my somewhat, and I don't know if it's, is it in camera? This is a fired round. It's been fired actually a number of times, and the case is still at 0.885. Trim spec for 45 ACP is 0.888. This is a brand new Winchester case. Has not been fired. You can see it. I think it's Winchester. It should be. Yeah. The primer's still good, and the case is clean. And we're at 8.891. Okay. So you take a fired case, and it's still within, you know, it hasn't expanded to the point where trimming is necessary. In fact, it's right in the sweet spot of that. So I asked him what the specs were on his crimp area, and he told me that it was 0.479 or 0.476. I couldn't remember exactly which one, and I just remember thinking that that measurement was off, because normally the case mouth after final seating is somewhere, it should be about 0.473 at the max. And, you know, 0.479 is way past that. I mean, it 6 thousandths of an inch doesn't sound like a lot, but in a, especially a new chamber, it would be quite a bit. because he did state that they wouldn't feed in his weapon, which was supposedly a new one, but it chambered just fine in his friend's 45. And I'm assuming that was a used weapon, or at least a more friendly chamber, as I should say. The rounds he were putting together did work. An example of this is a Remington round, and here you have, I don't know if you can see it, but 470 is the case mouth measurement there. This is a Winchester Talon case mouth, 469. This is one of my loads. I have a spear gold dot in there, and I'm at 469. So at 479 or 476, whatever it originally was, it was creating an issue in chambering due to the crimp he was putting on it. And he did mention he was waiting for a Lee crimp die to come in. And as you all know, I don't really like the term crimp die or factory crimp die, because basically in straight wall cases what you're doing is just taking the bell off. So let's illustrate that real quick. I have four cases. One is drastically overbelled, and then I work my way down to what I consider what I use as a bell. So I'm going to show you what a drastically overbell case would look like. I don't know. You can see how it just flares out there. You see that? Now, it does, for the beginner, it makes seating the bullet much easier, right? And kind of speeds up the process if you're not doing a dance with your bullet before you get it seated completely. The problem with this is that you keep working the case mouth with that kind of flaring and then debelling, this is going to become a weak spot. Even with a straight wall case, you're just going to work the brass into a a failure state eventually. So I moved on down, and this is an overbelled case, but less so. I hope you can see that. You can see the bell is not as pronounced, but it is still there. And again, the bullet sits rather comfortably. So moving even further, you'll notice that the belling is starting to be more in line with the wall of the case itself. Bullet sits in there. Still too much. And then this is mine. It's almost difficult to see that the case is belled at all. This is a properly belled case. The bullet does sit. Okay. But it's not as convenient, which is fine with me, because it's not a race to load these things. And you take your time, you get the bullet properly seated, See, all of these, this is a golden saber. Right? It's, but, you know, it's not the job of your fingers to seat the bullet. It is the job of the bullet seating die. And this is a Talon bullet. All right. So the, just as a visual, let's see if we can get the, and don't use my numbers as far as what your crimp is. Everybody has to do it based on the brass they're using. The over crimped one is 50.504 at the mouth. Okay. Sorry if these aren't in camera, but lighting's pretty doggone bad in here. The second step down, tightening up the bell, 0.482. All right. So we're getting closer. All right. Further on down. 0.475. And then 0.470. Okay. Now, 0.470 is pretty much unfired cases at 0.468, right? So you see how close to the factory new brass measurement a good bell will be. It's almost barely perceptible. So let's just, as a, this is a, this whole thing is a matter of a demonstration. I'm not actually loading anything in these rounds. I want to bring out the point of the crimp aspect of it. It is still puzzling some people. So we've got the proper bell, right? Now, just so you know, I'm going to use the grossly overbelled case, and I'll just put a golden saber in that one. All right, see how nicely, I'm gonna see if I can zoom in just a little bit here, because see how easy it is just to set the bullet on there, and that's what new reloaders like. They just don't want to fuss with this stuff and want to just get rounds popping out as fast as they can, which is not a good idea. So anyway, we're going to seat that golden saber. Get out of the way here. All right. You see the, I'm probably too close to, you can still see that bell on there, right? And this is why people think, gotta have that crimp. So let's move the round to the final stage and do the crimp. I'll have you know that my See now this. Is you can feel that it's there, but you can see, let's see if I can get this in camera here. You can see where the case is being bent back and forth at the mouth from the extreme belling. That's eventually going to be a weak spot. So let's just speed this up and we'll go to my bell. And again, I'll use the talon. I'll use a golden saber. This is the spirit gold. So it takes you a little bit longer to place the bullet in a nice vertical position, but your better dies are gonna straighten that bullet out anyway. If you're not going too fast, give the die a chance to orient itself on the bullet. And you can see, at this point, the bullet is seated properly. There's no indication of wear at the case mouth from excessive belling and debelling. Basically, that isn't debelling it to the extent that a factory crimp die would do. So if we move it to the final stage, that is a get out of here. That is a properly loaded, except for the fact that it's a dummy round, properly seated bullet. And you can almost see, I don't know if I can, you can almost see the lip of the case mouth. And this is what the round headspace is off of. So it has to be visible. It has to be detectable with your hands or fingers. This, as I said, is a factory Winchester Talon. You can put it up against mine. They are there's no crimp on this to speak of. They took the bell off. You can readily feel the edge of the case mouth, identical to mine. The point of this video is people are so fixated on crimping that they think that if there's not a good crimp on a round, then the bullet's going to move around, you know, and this bullet is not going anywhere. It's not going anywhere. You don't need an excessive crimp of any kind on a straight wall case to keep a bullet in place. A bullet setback is, if the case has been prepped properly, a bullet setback will not occur. And you don't need any kind of strongman crimp on the round to keep that bullet in place. In fact, you're going in the wrong direction if you do. Bottom line, if you are belling a case, only open the mouth to the point where the bullet just barely sits on it. without assistance. If it sits there comfortably, you've got too much, right? If it sits there, you know, you just sit there and you place it on there, and let me get back out, I'm sorry. If it sits there without any, you know, assistance, you just drop it on there, it's too wide. All right, so you start off by a minimalist belling, and then you wind up at the end stage with a case that's already got a well-seated bullet, and the requirement of putting a crimp on it is negated almost entirely. I hope I didn't bore everybody. I'm sure I did, but again, it's important that you don't get carried away with crimps on these straight wall cases, otherwise you're gonna run into a number of different issues. I'm gonna put a link down below to my crimping part 2 video. It is a more visual in-depth explanation of what's going on when you crimp a straight wall case. Anyway, I gotta have a few beers to calm my system down from that basketball game. I gotta put some, I don't know what I'm gonna do. I think I'm gonna do a lemon Greek roasted chicken and potatoes for dinner tonight, but pasta sauce, the marinara sauce I did last night, unreal. Guys ought to try that if you get a chance. Anyway, hope everybody has a wonderful weekend. Everybody have fun, be safe. JR10/Desert Gold out.